My going to speak is really light. Hope you had a good conversation. We'd like to open this meeting, the regular meeting of August 13th, the Board of Directors of the East Bay Regional Park District, and Dee Rosario will lead us in the pledge. Please join me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I need approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Ryan and Wolfe, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Do we have any public comments at this time?
Yes, Madam President, we have one public comment. That's Kelly Abreu.
All right. Mr. Abreu?
Yeah, 15 minutes, sir. 15 minutes. 3 minutes. Excuse me. 3 minutes, sir.
Let the record show me corrected.
So, 3 minutes. I don't know where my brain was at.
The parking crisis at Mission Peak, the board approved $1.6 million for parking expansion in September, on September 20th, 2016. That's on this green sheet of paper. You already saw this, so I didn't put it on the handout. It just says authorized appropriation to complete design and permitting. Right there, complete design and permitting. That has a very significant meaning. It means you entered into a new phase of the project. It's a special phase. It's a different phase. It's not preliminary design anymore. The agreement to enforce parking restrictions on Fremont City Streets will expire in July 2020. At the same time as the expiration of the temporary residential parking permit program. The lease agreement with the city for 900 acres of parkland will also expire at the same time. The lease are stretched in for the park district, patrolling 120,000 acres of parks, trails, and high crime areas, diverting limited resources to enforce parking restrictions near Mission Peak is hard to justify. The district hasn't maintained the white faded lines in the existing 40-space parking lot. The parking laws are enforced mercilessly, with little discretion. Motorists who cross the faded white lines the day before yesterday are hit with $43 parking tickets. Other regional parks have wheel stops to install to keep cars from parking over the white lines. However, wheel stops have not been installed at the Sanford Avenue lot, and the white lines have not been repainted. The pictures right here. All those pictures were taken day before yesterday, and those are the little white papers is the real parking tickets there, at least four of them. Still going on. And the district should prioritize crime prevention over parking enforcement. Prevention is the key word. The district should not punish visitors for the laxity of the maintenance department or the incompetence of the operations department. At least four motorists were ticketed day before yesterday for crossing lines. The unjust ticketing impacts park visitors and their families. Ticketing campaign is perverse since public safety department is supposed to, quote, provide a public service, unquote. Other departments, factions within the district are digging in their heels by declining to install wheel stops and paint the lines. They are at loggerheads with their own taxpayers and park visitors, the people they're supposed to serve. Park visitors and guests need your help. Clearly, the ball is in the district's court. The mission of the district is worthy, and it should uphold its 85-year tradition of service to the public. Thank you.
Thank you.
15 minutes. We appreciate it. Okay, consent calendar. I'm going to first state that my sinuses are about there, and so I'm trying to hear, but everybody's speaking up. That won't help. Thank you. Anybody's got a cure, please let me know. Any items that you know about at this stage?
Yes, Madam President. We had several items. The questions may have already been answered, so I'm going to go with Director Rosario. Item A.
A.
Item H.
H.
And item K.
K?
Yes.
K.
Were those questions answered sufficient, or do you want to...
A, H, and K?
Yes.
You can take K off of it.
You're going to remove K?
We remove K.
Okay.
We're down to
so,
A and H.
And H. Okay, the next set of questions are from Director Corbett. Item or comment. items M,
yeah.
O, R, and S.
F?
S as in Sam. Yes. M, O, R, and S. And I know you haven't had those. I know that. So those are still open. Do we have any other?
Hey, recall what I think you said, and if it doesn't work, somebody will take care of that, I'm sure. We're going to start with A, Director Rosario.
I'm the treasurer, and I overlook all the checks. And I met with Deborah Ocker and Jeff Rasmussen recently because I wanted to see how we were tracking our energy that we're producing out of this Shadow Cliffs solar array, and had a great discussion. And I was very, very happy to see it on our the Treasury's check sheets that we are now tracking the 50 meters that are benefiting from the solar array, and we can see how much money we're actually saving. So for future treasures, that will be, you'll be able to see that.
Happy note.
Yes, very happy note. So, thank you so much for all that. It's a lot of work.
And we will be bringing our first annual update to the executive committee in September.
Okay.
On the
thank
solar
you very much.
Energy plan.
That will be interesting for all of us, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, next item was 8H.
Mm-hmm.
Director Rosario.
Item 8H is the anniversary of Outdoor Afro. I just wanted to make a comment that this is an amazing grassroots organization that started in Oakland. And it's amazing how it's affected other cultures of color. Out of Outdoor Afro has grown Latino Outdoor, Asian Outdoor, and I think this is, I'm happy that we're celebrating this anniversary and getting people of color into our parks and reclaiming the use of the outdoors. So that's all I wanted to say.
Do you have the impression that the group is growing?
Yeah, it's huge. It's
well, nationwide. I mean, that's important to say.
Yeah, yeah, it's very, it's huge. It's like I said, came out of a blog out of the city of Oakland, and started with Blue Map, and you know, she's an amazing woman, and now it's nationwide.
Terrific.
Huge organization, so thank you.
And Dee, we have worked with Rue, the executive director, from the beginning, and a great leader, but also she's very clear that the early experience she had camping in a park made her life different, and she has lived that all the way through college, all the way through other things that she's done. She just always goes back to what she actually considers a reverse bias, which is that people have no interest in the black community, and it's not true. They haven't had the opportunity. She was given the opportunity, and it changed her life. It's a great story, and we need to keep that support going for that organization.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Next one was M, and that is Director
Corbett. Yes, thank you. I support this measure, but I did want to get a little bit more information. I understand that these upgrades are happening as a result of meeting design and software standard upgrades, and that it's making the helicopter system the communication system mission ready, but I'd like to know what that means.
So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Officer Hargrove of the Airport Unit. Basically, it means that all the cities and counties within those two areas can interoperate. They can communicate when necessary, and that's for events such as terrorism, mass casualty, natural disaster, and even cross-border operations between cities. And without it, this is a standard that's been accepted and required, and without this equipment, we can't talk to them.
So this is to further the program that's been going on for a number of years to increase interoperability throughout the region.
That's correct, and it's a mandatory requirement for all cities and counties. It's required by the middle of next year.
Great, thank you very much for that explanation.
Thank you. Anything further, Eleanor? No, that's okay. Great. The next item is O.
And call it a question.
On M? Okay.
Just what about Eagle 6? This applies just to Eagle 7.
Is there
Eagle 6? This authorization just applies to Eagle 7. Sorry, I was just curious. Eagle 6 is up to the same.
One more question.
Did you hear the question?
Thank you.
Yes. It does not apply to Eagle 6 because Eagle 6 we hope to replace with Eagle 8. Eagle 8 will require at that time.
Okay.
Planning ahead.
Eagle 6.
Thank you.
Okay. With that, we will go to item O, authorization to purchase two Toyota RAV4 hybrid vehicles from Freeway Toyota. And this is Director Corbett.
Well, first of all, I'd like to express my deep appreciation
for
the hybrid vehicles being purchased as part of our fleet towards our, our greening goals. So thank you very much for that. And I did notice that these are two vehicles, one that will be used for information services and the one at the Sinnoh Visitor Center. And they're hybrids, so obviously they can be operated by gas or by electric. Do we have charging stations at Sinnoh yet in order to make sure that we have the opportunity to charge this when possible?
Jim O'Connor, Assistant General Manager of Operations. I'm going to ask Kelly Barrington, our Chief of Mass, who manages fleet. I know they're plug-in hybrid, but I'm not sure if they require like a level 2 charging station like you would with an electric vehicle. It may be a simple 110 cord to charge the vehicle overnight, so maybe Kelly has some information.
And typically the Toyota hybrids can be charged with a regular.
We're
not going to have a charging station. I just want to make sure if we're purchasing the vehicles, we have the opportunity to actually use them on their by electric.
So noted, yeah, we wouldn't have purchased the vehicle without
a
concurrent charging station in that situation. But let me see if Kelly has an answer.
Thank you.
Director Corbin, member of the board, Kelly Barrington, Chief of Maintenance and Skill Trade. Yeah, we're going to use a simple 110 charging method for these. There's no charging infrastructure at Sinnoh yet, and not a lot of opportunity to do it at this point. But as we do finish the electrical upgrades and the study for green fleet stuff, we're looking all over the district for opportunity to put in new charging stations.
And the other vehicle assigned to information services, is that assigned here to the district office?
I believe so.
Where we have charging stations. Okay, thank you so very much. Really appreciate that we're moving in this direction. Thank you.
Director Lofty?
Kelly, I just
don't go anywhere, Kelly.
Just have one more question. As you know, I fully support the greening of our fleet and lowering our energy footprint, but I did happen to be at South County Courtyard yesterday. What was that smart car? I hope everyone in the smart car was okay.
Have
you seen it?
I have not.
That smart car. God.
Are you referring to the one that's stored in the back lot? That's kind of
No, the one that got the.
Do we know anything about this
smart car?
We're not replacing those.
Hope
everybody's
okay.
Yeah, they are.
Okay,
yeah,
good.
Fine. Yep.
Now we are all
curious. Those little cars look awful when they get hit.
Because we're recording the meeting, I really wasn't clear on that conversation, and I'm sure people that are listening are not. Could you just, what exactly were you asking?
I was asking the welfare of the park person that was driving the smart car that was part of our fleet. That whenever there's an accident, they usually get towed back to one of the service yards. I was up at the service yard, and if you hit a big giant Ford pickup truck, it makes a certain amount of dent. This car was crushed, but
yes.
You're telling us the occupant was okay.
Yeah, it was Kevin Danster, our supervising naturalist. He had minor injuries after that, but it was pretty amazing, and we're very glad that he was unhurt.
All right. Thank you.
Jim O'Connor, that was the accident happened almost over a year ago.
Yes. Yeah,
okay.
That's
kind of
why.
So, and well, one of the things is the car was it did its job. It was designed to collapse and accept the force of the accident. But the other thing I should note is those smart cars. I'm not even sure they're still in production, but they're no longer part of our fleet.
Next item is authorization to apply for grant funds from the Wildlife Conservation Board Public Access Program, Martin Luther King and Point Pinot, Beverly Lane.
I just want to say thank you for applying for this. Are you there?
There she is.
because this area as part of the water trail, I just think is a really significant one as we go along. And so I hope you're successful with that grant.
She has a pretty good record, so why not? The next item would be R, an approval of application for grant funds for the Green Infrastructure Grant Program for the San Francisco Bay Trail Doolittle Drive South, walk along the Cane Shoreline. And this was
Ellen,
Director
Corbett.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Also, as Director Lorraine said, I very much appreciate that we're applying for this grant as well for this park. I was just hoping, I'm very supportive of this, and I'm glad to see that there's funding available to continue to fill in the places on the Bay Trail that need to be completed, and particularly happy to see there's funding at the state level for extending trails in areas that are more economically challenged. Very much appreciate that funding is available and that we are applying for it. But I was hoping we could just, this is something I'll ask for more information at a later time, but in taking a look at the map that we have in our packet of the area and showing where the trail is, which we all know because this has come before us a couple times now for various other approvals. And taking a look at this map, I'm just hopeful if we are continue to apply for funding for economically challenged areas where we have parks, that we also look at ways to actually connect to the neighborhoods. This is very important because it does connect to the Bay Trail and eventually that to the Green Bay, and it does bring a lot of neighborhoods together. But in looking at this map, it sort of just jumps out to me that the neighborhoods are like over here, and they have other barriers that impact a person's ability to get from the economically challenged areas actually to use these particular trails. So I'm hoping at some point, as we continue to work towards bringing in this funding, I can talk to some staff to just sort of find out what our plans are to make more connections. I know that GM's heard me talk about this before, but very interested in making sure that we actually connect to the neighborhoods when we can.
If you see any grants that works for, go for it.
So would there be an opportunity for me to meet with someone on staff to talk about this more specifically?
Yes, you're welcome. We can talk about that further, who's the right staff, probably planning department, but the master plan is pretty clear on where the priorities are, and we certainly can work with Oakland and other communities, San Leandro, to get better access. We do that with AC Transit, too,
because
that's really a big challenge, not having the right routes and the right location for our park, so we'll continue to do to work on that.
And it is a difficult challenge because our partners are not working with us as closely as I think we would like them to, but I want to continue to work on this issue.
Right.
Thank you.
And just a comment on that grant, this is a very large grant, so it will be very in line with a lot of competition from other communities. I think this is the largest grant we've applied for in a while, particularly from this new area. So I really appreciate our assertiveness in doing this, but I also caution to the board that it is a big request and fairly new program. And so it doesn't have a track record of what they really are their priorities, so we'll certainly have our legislative advocacy in full effort to try to get this grant approved.
Thank you. All right, next item, S, authorization to apply for grant funds from the Wildlife Conservation Board Monarch Butterfly and Pollinator Rescue Program, Point Pinole Regional Shoreline. Director Corbett.
Another great application for grant funds. And I'm just wondering, do we have an overall district-wide pollinator plan? I know that from time to time we do these really great programs in our parks. And the reason I ask this question is I do know that some other districts, when you send me off to these conferences, I come back with ideas. And I do know that some of the districts have overall pollinator plans for the entire district. And I'm just wondering, do we have anything similar to that?
So Matt Grawl, Chief of Stewardship. Director Corbett, thanks for the question. We do not have a district-wide plan. We've done more site-specific plans for the sites where we have overwintering monarchs. So we've been working at Point Pinole, Ardenwood for many years, and then more recently at Oyster Bay to help support the colony there at St. Leonard Golf Course. We've started to look at parts in the east part of the district to plant more milkweed for the host plants. We started doing some mapping out there, and we're looking to do more enhancements of the plants that will support their breeding habitat, because we really want them to move from the areas that they overwinter on the shoreline that I mentioned at first out into East County. So that's something we're starting to look at on the landscape level, but we don't have a plan in place at the moment.
So at some point, I'd love to set up a meeting and talk a little more about this issue as well.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. And Director Corbett, if you mentioned that other agencies or districts have plans like that, we'd love to, if you've got any of those copies, that would be very helpful for staff to have.
Yeah, I'll do some research and share it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I can only tell you, as a little more citizen, I've yet to gather a monarch coming near my milkweed, but I'll keep trying. They don't seem to like East County. Any further questions or comments on the consent calendar? If not, then I'd like a motion. Do
second.
Lane and Corbett, discussion? Anybody? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. Thank you.
President Liz Kemp, we'd like to take a very short break to reboot the sound system. Evidently, we need to reboot the...
I think rebooting sounds good.
We'll reboot.
Reboot.
Reboot. So.
I think the troops are... Thank you.
Yeah, he had some space.
You give us a shot and we hit in all directions. But we're back. All right. We will now go on to Acquisition, Stewardship, and Development Division. First item, authorization to appropriate funds to the Dredge Pond and Repair Levy Project, Hayward Regional Shoreline.
Members of the Board, President of this camp, Matt Grawl, Chief of Stewardship. Today I'm going to talk about and give basically the background and talk about the need for some of this work and where we're at with permitting the work. And then Lisa is going to talk more about some of the construction details and specifically what's going to happen in each location. This is a project in this area, something we've been working on, you know, for many years, and it's the area is near and dear to many of our hearts, the Hayward Shoreline. And I did intentionally put two pictures on the front here because this really has two purposes for this work. One is to protect the wildlife out there at the marsh, protect a lot of the shorebirds that are nesting, and then also to protect the Bay Trail and to protect access along that trail. In the past, we've had a lot of levee issues out there with some of the Bay Trail levees. And, you know, today we're working on a plan to do some preventative maintenance so we don't have any emergencies out there on the Bay Trail this winter. So that's a big portion of what we're doing. But today, we're going to ask that you recommend the transfer and appropriation of about $800,000 into a project that's already established called Dredge Ponds and Repair Levees. This money is for Measure WW development funds from the Hayward Shoreline allocation area, and these funds were specifically designated when established WW for this type of work. We knew we would have these issues, and this is a part of the reason we established this fund when we were developing WW was to maintain the levees and the shoreline trails out there. So what's needed, and just to give a little overview of the area on your map here, you can see that the top of the map is Orloma Marsh. As we move down the shoreline to the south, the next big marsh is Cogswell Marsh, and then south from there is the Hayward Marsh. And so today we're really talking about two areas, the Orloma Marsh and then also the Hayward Marsh. Both of these projects are being worked on in different ways, and I just want to give you some of that context. So at Orloma Marsh, we have two things that are going to happen. We're going to repair a bridge here to get access to these areas, and then we have about five sites along the shoreline that need to be repaired. And as part of those repairs, today the money is going to be used really to buy the supplies for that site. We're going to be buying the rock, and then that work on those sites is going to be done by Roads and Trails because they're five smaller sites, they're discrete sites, and we're permitting those under our routine maintenance permit. So those five repairs in the past have had challenges. And now we have all those permits in place, and we're able to do those five projects this year during our fall maintenance season. Now, additionally, though, we've had some issues down here with the Hayward Marsh. And in the Hayward Marsh, we have a culvert that's plugging going into one of the basins, and we've also had some levee repairs that are really making it dangerous for staff to be out there and continue operating the marsh, and also to maintain some of the volunteers that come out to maintain the Least Darn Colony. So those levees are really deteriorating, and we're concerned about what may happen if we don't do anything in this next winter season. It could make some of those levees impassable. So what we're talking about now is really the bare minimum to maintain those levees and to protect the nesting habitat for the California Least Terns, and then also to maintain the water quality in the Hayward Marsh so we have good nesting water nesting next year. So just some background though on the Hayward Marsh. I know it's something we've talked a lot. We've talked about future operations and what's going to happen there. The Hayward Marsh was built in 1985 and started operating as a wastewater marsh. About 5-6 years ago, we started really having some issues with these levee failures, and we knew it was a systemic problem through the whole marsh. We needed to do a major renovation and a rehabilitation of that marsh. We did a feasibility study in partnership with Union Sanitary District, and we determined that the cost to maintain that full marsh in operation would be between $20 and $28 million. At that time, both agencies really came to a mutual agreement that it was best to not pursue that project, to maintain the marsh as a treatment marsh, and it would be better for us to look at the district, to look at restoring the area, to be able to provide better habitat and some public access, and for USD to work on other options for storing wastewater and wet weather flows. And so what they're looking at now is upgrading their plant to improve the water quality so they have a flexibility to discharge at other locations or to do storage at another place. So we're working through that process with them, and we're ready. We're going to be moving that forward and for restoration. And anything we're doing today, though, and we're proposing to keep this area in operation and maintain the habitat, will not preclude any future restoration opportunities out there. And in many ways, are really going to enhance and improve the restoration opportunities in the future, because we'll have good access and we'll also maintain that habitat before we can do a much larger restoration. So for the Hayward Marsh restoration, we will be releasing an RFP later this fall to develop a design for the Hayward Marsh restoration. And we will also be applying for grant funds to complete that restoration design. And then later this year, we'll be developing an MOU with the Union Sanitary District to set some dates on when we'll be stopping discharge into the marsh and to really memorialize our intention to do future restoration. And so those are some of the bigger things happening out there, but really to keep things going, we need to do these additional repairs. So Lisa's now going to talk about some of the additional repairs at both the Orloma and the Hayward Marsh site.
Good afternoon, Director Muskamp, directors. I'm Lisa Gorgian, Chief of Design and Construction. So as Matt talked about sort of the bigger picture, I'm just going to quickly go through the three discrete projects that we're talking that are board actions for you this afternoon. So as Matt mentioned, there's several locations along the levees that need to be repaired, but in order for us to get safely to those levees, we need to do some repair works to the Orloma Bridge. And so there's some flaking, there's some concrete reinforcement that needs to happen based on some exposed steel. So we're going to be bringing in, using the job order contracting method, some contractors to come in and fix that. That'll be done first, and then after that's done, then our crews can go in and start working on the levees. So this is one of the pictures of the levees, a picture of one of the levee areas right now. On the left side of the arrow, sort of the top of the arrow, you can see there's some black, and that's filter fabric that's becoming exposed. So as part of this work, we're going to be recontouring so that we can get the toe of the slope reestablished, build up that levee, that rock wall again, and then address some of the pooling that's been going on along the trail. As the tides come in, it overtops that levee right now, and so the Bay Trail gets has some ponding on it, so we'll want to prevent that. So that's where those locations, those are the type of repairs that will be happening. And then finally, down in the Hayward Marsh area, this is an example of the repair work that's going to be happening with these ponds, where we're going to be balancing cut and fill, so they'll be coming in, scooping out the base of it, and then recontouring the sides. And again, that's to stabilize the top of the levees to build those back up to make them safer for our volunteers, our park staff to maintain, and then also for water quality within the ponds to be able to maintain that and to preserve those islands that are so critical for the lease terns. And so with that, those are just sort of a little quicker, deeper dive into the work that we're doing. And I'm going to turn it back to the end to our recommendation and then bring Matt up for any questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Director Lane.
I really appreciate our having a chance to take a field trip to see this. It helped a lot. I'm wondering, we're calling it a dredge ponds and repair, levees project. Is any of this a permanent improvement? We're calling it all repair.
The levee repairs would be somewhat of a permanent improvement. We think we're repairing them in this way. This is something we haven't done before. But the interior levees we're talking about, at least within the marsh, we think we can then, after we do this, we will be able to, with roads and trails in the future, maintain them as we have small failures, so we can go into small discrete projects. What we're talking about now within those is about 3,000 linear feet of levee around that area. So it's very extensive work, and it's going to take a lot of work to do that now. But the dredging, it would be just the dredging, we're only really dredging around one culvert to keep flow coming into the marsh. As part of the restoration, we're going to have a major dredging effort to reestablish water in certain areas and to build marsh in other areas that we haven't designed. So really this is just temporary as far as the dredging now to keep water flow over the next several years while the marsh is still in operation.
More questions? Anyone? Director Lossy?
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions, Matt. So I know that the necessity of rehabbing the Oraloma Bridge. I guess my question would be, how old is that bridge, and is it going to be a repair? Or, you know, I've been out there on a king tide, and it's pretty close. Is there any thought of rebuilding the whole thing, or because it's a repair permit, we don't have the ability to do that, or have these things been thought of? And is there a more resilient bridge? Because I know the bridge is always...
Yeah, I think I'm going to let Lisa answer more of that, the detail on that. I think the main thing we're looking at now, though, is getting access to those shoreline, and in these minor repairs can make it safe to access the repair sites. But as far as the long-term plans.
Thank you. Lisa Gorshin again. So one of our budget program areas is bridge evaluation. So we have a whole program now to begin to look at all of our bridges throughout the district and prioritize them. And so this would be part of that. So for right now, as Matt mentioned, this is an interim to make sure we have safe access to do this repair work. But it, in the longer term, we'll want to evaluate it within our whole district and prioritize fixing them or replacing them, much like we just recently did with the Glenside Olivera Bridge in Lafayette.
So do you have a cost on what the repair to cross it and get access to be?
Can you just say that again?
Well, yeah, you said we're not looking at replacing it for the long term. We just want to fix it so we can get our equipment across to fix the levees. Do you have a cost for that?
We're working with the job order contracting contractor right now to evaluate what that cost would be. So we, as part of this budget request, we estimated what it would be. So, and that's, I don't think we specifically called that out, but it's probably about $200,000. And so we're refining those costs right now to make sure we have the means and methods that are acceptable to us to move forward with that work.
Great. And then does anybody else use that bridge? I mean, today, I know we have everybody goes out on that levee. Do we have any leverage on that levee to get some other folks to contribute? No, it's all ours.
Yeah, Matt Colgan. I'm not sure about that one. I do know that some of the areas PG&E has to get out because there are certain transformers and things out in that area. And I know some of that, so I'm pretty sure in the past when the emergency repairs, that was a need to get through that area for PG&E work. But I'm not aware of any other entity that has an ongoing operational need to get through on that bridge, at least. I think there's other ways to come in through West Linton, through the landfill, I think is where most of Alameda County's access comes through.
Okay, and then one more, this rehabilitation. is going to enhance the lease turn island, or
the work here will just maintain water flows to that area. We're not doing any work on the lease turn island. We're just trying to maintain water flow and the appropriate water levels in the basin, so the one they're protected from predators, and we have enough water for them to be able to forage during their nesting period.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
And, if I may, so we've done a lot of work, Matt, on climate resilience and sea level rise. I know that there are studies going on for the whole shoreline. This funding kind of in the direction that Director Waspy is going, this is a contribution to the immediate needs, but we are not raising the levee levels at all, because that's probably multi-million dollar projects to do that. But I think anytime we're doing work, we need to keep in mind that whatever structures we're building there that are new or repaired will be helpful in looking at the resistance to sea level rise. The king tides are becoming a regular, more than regular, event every year, and so we're going over the tops of levees and bridges now much more frequently and much higher than we used to. But I think probably the answer is going to be we have to do a lot, the more comprehensive view of that. So if you can reference anything now that I know we're looking at, HASPA and HARD, for looking at a larger picture of what to do on the shoreline. Because I think the timing is such, I referenced to legal counsel my call with BCDC that said, we need an emergency permit again this year. And the executive director said, if it happens every year, it's not an emergency. So the long-term solution is really the solution. And I think we all have to be focused on that much bigger solution, which is probably $20 to $50 million. So that needs to be a very high priority on our legislative side, because we cannot fund that alone.
Yeah, thanks for those comments, General Manager Doyle. Yeah, I agree with all that. Yes, we're working on it. And we also, with the Hayward Shoreline, HASPA is working on Hayward Shoreline Master Plan and looking at the areas of vulnerability and what are some of the potential opportunities along this area to increase levee heights or do other activities, nourish gravel beaches, add gravel beaches, add other habitat features that can help provide more resiliency, and what opportunities are out there. So to help give us a menu of options, and then we can look at what's feasible, what fits the district's needs. And certainly with the Hayward Marsh restoration, we will be definitely looking at this. But when you look at it, though, in many ways, the Hayward Marsh is a very short section of that entire shoreline. So any of the work there is going to have to be integrated into future opportunities. And at that site, we also have a lot of additional opportunities, because there is an upland area on the eastern edge of the Hayward Marsh. And so that we have a little bit more flexibility there with what we do as far as building levees on the interior side. So we're going to have quite a bit of options to look at in that area when we do the restoration planning later this year.
I just don't want the district to overlook that these are Band-Aids. Even though it's $800,000, they're still Band-Aids. And this has got to be a long-term focus. That's our longest piece of vulnerable shoreline right now. It's made of old Leslie salt and Oliver salt, stuff they pulled out to create the salt ponds. So I look at Oyster Bay and the Dumbart Quarry and see all the material we're bringing in to complete those projects. But at some point in time, when we're done with that, there may be a source of future fill. And what we've learned is that there's a lot more material coming out of very small projects that's feasible to use, and we don't want to lose that. In fact, that's what they did on the southeast side, the southwest side of the bay, with the huge Don Edwards Wildlife Area restoration they did there. They were bringing dirt in to create all that new restoration. So it's just, we need to have a long-term vision and not lose sight of this, because this is a huge cost to the district.
And as we develop more plans for the marsh restoration, others, there will be opportunities through the exec committee and natural resources committee to kind of look at how we're proceeding with this, and multiple opportunities for input and to make sure we're hitting the targets that the general manager mentioned.
Okay.
Anyone else have any questions or comments? If not, then I would ask for a motion.
Madam President, we do have one speaker on this item, Kelly Abreu.
Mr. Abreu.
it was a technical, highly technical paper, scientific paper published, I think, a couple of years ago on use of the radar interferometry to measure land heights and subsidence around the bay. Very technical. They found that the maximum rate of subsidence was someplace like Treasure Island, it happened each year, and other places were something like around the bay. We're sinking pretty fast, and that was around like an eighth of an inch a year. So what that tells me is you go out there and you see everything looks just the same as it did 20 years ago or whatever, that's sinking. Everything you see is sinking, especially, and your levees are sinking too. So anybody who says that you're not adding on, maybe if you lost levee height, could be a consideration. I don't know. Anybody who does, you've got to go out and do careful measurements to know if your levees are even the same height as they used to be. That's a very technical, but that's called subsidence, all right? And then the shoreline master plan with the administrative coordination between the Hayward Area shoreline and this district. This district needs to be sending in a lot of people like Matt Grawl and other people to coordinate with HASPA, because there's what I found out at HASPA meetings, and I've been to a couple of them, there's a lot of agencies with a finger in this pot, and like Director Wasby said, maybe they said they should be paying too. Look at these words here. These are the exact same kind of words, legal words. There's a legal question here. There's a legal question about the ability of the staff, based on these words, to carry out the instructions of this board. Look at the words, appropriate funds from Measure WW. And that's the words I got on this sheet of paper from 3 years ago. 3 years from now, you can have some staff coming and saying, but that doesn't really mean that we had to go and start digging and dredging and repairing and whatever. Maybe it meant that we were supposed to do preliminary design and permitting, but it seems like you skipped that stage. You're just going straight into work, not even that. But whatever it is you claim to be doing there, using these words, authorize funding for Measure W and appropriate and do things based on these particular legal words. Well, these words, the same words, didn't work at Mission Peak. 3 years have gone by, and there's still legal questions surrounding these words. So I want to know if these words are actually going to work. And if they work, and they do work, then how come they're not working? Right here, 3 years ago, Mission Peak authorized the appropriation, and the work, and people are going, well, I don't know. I don't know if that's really need authorized the work of preliminary design and funding. We need to get these words actually carried out by staff. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Do I have a motion?
Yes. I would move that we transfer appropriate funds to the dredge ponds and repair levees project at Hayward Regional Shoreline.
Director Wasby? Do I have a second? Director Rosario? Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Against? Motion passes. Go dredge and rebuild the bridge so it's safe. I think that all sounds like a good idea, waiting for the 20 mil. Okay, the next item, authorization to execute a contract with RPR Architects for consulting services and appropriate funds to the renovate pool project, Roberts Regional Recreation Area.
Good afternoon. This is Lisa Borgin again, Chief of Design and Construction. I'm just going to give sort of a welcome overview to this project.
Okay.
So, and then Toby will talk. This is the first time we're coming to you about this project, so we thought it's a good time to talk and bring it to you. So this is for a major renovation and maintenance project that we're going to be looking at expanding the pool. It's a project that was identified in WW, so it's voter approved. And Toby's going to be following up, walking through the board material and our actions that we're requesting. But I did want to take a moment to say that we're here today to award this contract. We'll be back in front of you when we have a preliminary design in front of the executive committee to share that design. And then we'll come again to the board to award a construction contract. So just in terms of trying to be a little bit clear about when we'll be in front of the board with this project, I just wanted to share that this afternoon. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Toby, and he'll walk you through the board action today.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Madam President, board members. I'm Toby Perry, Project Manager in Design and Construction. And as Lisa stated, I'm here today seeking authorization to enter into a contract with RPR Architects to come up with a design for the renovation of Robert's Pool and to transfer and appropriate funds from WW to the project. And then while I'm here with you speaking today, I'm working with and representing a much larger project team, including park supervisor, park operations, and aquatics, among others. Here you can see in this picture the well-used and loved pool facility at Roberts. I'll just add that I've scattered a lot of photos of the pool facility throughout this presentation, and at the end, if there's questions or you want to see them again, I'm happy to kind of go back and share them again. So, here again is the recommendation, kind of just went over it. It's authorized an execution of a contract in the amount of $400,000 to RPR Architects. They're a small firm based in Oakland for design, construction document preparation, permitting, bidding and construction administrative support, and then to authorize a transfer and appropriation of $1.35 million from WW. So just to orient you, Roberts Regional Recreation Area is here in the Oakland Hills. It's off Skyline Boulevard. And then in addition to the pool facility, Roberts Regional Recreation Area has several picnic areas among some really beautiful redwood trees. There's a baseball field, sand, volleyball courts, play field, and a relatively new children's all-accessible play area. And also an amazing view of downtown Oakland and San Francisco Bay. So here's an aerial showing kind of the heart of that recreation area. Here's the swim facility, the visitor parking. Here's a little bit of that baseball field out there at the edge. The all accessible playground is right here. And then looking at the blow up of the swim area here, you can see that we have a five-lane pool surrounded on all four sides by a concrete pool deck. Here we have the changing rooms and bathrooms. This is the entrance to the pool facility, and then here we have a sloping grass lawn down to the pool. And then you can also see where we have some shade umbrellas and picnic tables that the district has provided. So the Roberts Pool was first constructed, and it was built in 1954. As you saw, it's a five-lane pool. It's 25 yards long. The width kind of varies. From one end, it's 40 feet wide. The other end, it's narrower, closer to 30 feet. The pool has an official capacity of 150, though the lifeguards feel that there are more people than they can safely watch, then they will close the pool area off to additional members of the public. And I'm told that this happens quite frequently, usually because there are too many people crowded into the shallow area of the pool. So the pool is open year-round. It's used year-round, and it's heated. It's open to the general public from the end of September through the middle of April. And then in addition to the general public, the pool is utilized by the district to train its lifeguard staff and to provide swim lessons. The pool hosts a large number of camps throughout the summer, and then when it's closed to the public in the wintertime, it's utilized by a local swim team. During the almost 5 months of the year when it is open to the public, the Roberts Pool averages approximately 20,000 visitors. So, as I mentioned, the pool was built in 1954, and since that time, there have been several maintenance and equipment upgrade-related projects, but there are mounting list of maintenance and compliance issues that require now a more major renovation of the facility. And that's in addition to the capacity-related reasons for renovation. The cast iron piping under the pool is rotting, which is resulting in gravel getting into the suction screen of the pump. And this is without question
kind of the biggest issue, and if this pipe was to completely fail, then the whole pool would have to be shut down for really an extended period of time. The filters are failing, which means that we're paying to replace them about every 2 years. The pool plaster is falling or flaking off. The grate on the pool drain needs to be replaced to be code compliant. The pool is not currently ADA compliant up to today's current code. The pool heater is inefficient, and there are cracks in the concrete in the pool deck that are a trip hazard. And I thought this image was especially ironic with the large crack running right through the no running sign. So given that background, the proposed scope of the project to renovate the pool facility will be to replace the existing pool. We'll be looking at increasing the width of the pool, potentially to 7 lanes, which would allow for 5 swim competition lanes and then 2 cool down lanes. And then we'll specifically be looking to increase the pool capacity, especially that shallow, and in creating additional shallow areas of the pool. We'll be making the pool ADA compliant, either by installing permanent lifts or a slope entry. We'll be replacing the existing pool equipment, renovating the changing room and bathroom based on increased pool area capacity and ADA code, and then we'll be modifying the pool deck and grass lawn based on that final pool layout, and then constructing ADA parking and an accessible path of travel to get from the parking lot to the pool. So part of today's board action is to authorize the design contract. The scope of this contract would be to come up with a design for it, prepare the construction documents, permit the project, and then provide the bidding and construction support. We issued a request for proposal for this on June 11th, and on the deadline, July 9th, we received one proposal back from RPR Architects. Again, they're based here in Oakland. We reviewed their proposal. I interviewed and walked the site with them and checked references. We were impressed by their relevant project experience and their demonstrated expertise in this line of work. And then I also reached out to the City of San Leandro to discuss a very similar project that the City of San Leandro has been working on. They only received 2 design proposals for their project, and their fee schedule is very similar in amount. So that gave us a good reference point. So here you can see a high-level schedule for project completion. Driving this schedule is a desire to complete construction by the summer swim season of 2021. We'll be bringing back, as Lisa said, a conceptual plan for the executive committee to look at by the end of this year. And then the plan is to have construction documents complete next spring, so we can go up to bid in the summer and then start construction by the end of September or October of next year. Once the pool closes to the public. So really the goal here is to be in construction as soon as that summer swim season ends, such that we can be opening on schedule for the next year's swim schedule. We have right now an estimate of total project cost to be about $4 million, but part of that design, this design scope, is to really come up with a refined cost estimate that we'll share. With today's board action, we'll move $1.35 million out of WW into the project's budget, which will cover this design contract and leave about $1 million left for construction. So the remainder of the project funds will be identified as we move through the design process. And in fact, we're already working with grants to kind of explore some opportunities. So with that...
So, Toby, question.
Yeah.
So is that 1.35 the total remaining in WW for this? For that park?
And that's what I'm saying, yes.
So we have a significant deficit for this project.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Questions or comments? I will let Dave for Director Rosario.
Just a comment. I wholeheartedly support this project. This is one of our iconic areas and parks, and highly popular, well-used pool, and I would advocate for you maybe if you can squeeze another lane out of there, that'd be great. But now this is long overdue, and I'm glad we can move forward on this, because I think that that central line there, once that breaks, then we'll have to fix it this way. It's better that it's planned and won't interrupt a swim season. So thank you.
Director Lane. Yes, I've been up there often, and that's really a popular pool. Dee certainly knows better than I. So we are talking about making it larger in your 5 to 7 lanes. I have a couple of requests. One is, could you talk to them about trying to make a beautiful pool? We've had the same pool for 60 years, right?
65.
More. And so you build a pool, it's going to be there for a long time. So if you could just introduce the concept.
Absolutely. I think you can tell the designers who want it beautiful that
pretty cool.
They like to hear that.
Yeah, I'm sure they would like it. I don't know how much it would cost, but it's just to think about the fact that if you think about something like that, sometimes it can really happen. And then I want to bring up again ADA seating. I think it's important to have the accessibility here. I think all of us agree with that, and this is something the Park District's been working on for well over a decade, to do as much accessible as we can. So I think that's very important. But I did have the experience when we were redoing part of the all abilities playground of sitting on their handicap bench. And I actually had the same experience when I went to Grand Teton last month, and they had redone Jenny Lake. Have any of you been there? It was beautiful, and they had done all kinds of design things, handicap circular walk, and handicap benches. And I think there is a flaw in what we are accepting from the federal government for handicapped benches. And so I would just like to invite any of you, and in particular Lisa, who is not really tall. How tall are you, Lisa?
I like to think I'm 5'3".
She's going to stretch it, I can tell. Yeah, because when I sat on the robber's bench when I was first put there, and I took a seat on the Jenny Lake bench, the only way you could be comfortable if you were about 6'2", because your feet dangle over the end.
Dangle over.
And I just don't understand why the federal government is providing that as the template for handicapped benches. I think it's a gross error, and I'm really sorry if we feel like we have to follow that for funding or some other reason. Because it's totally not, I mean, I have to scooch around, try and be comfortable, and there's no way I can put my back on the bench. And my sister-in-law, who's 5'2", was totally uncomfortable. And so I don't think we should be setting up a handicap bench that's uncomfortable for abled people, to say nothing of disabled people. So that's my rant. For Roberts right now.
Who is the federal government who wants to appeal to?
Well, I don't care. I mean,
somebody under
is the federal government paying any attention? I mean, our benches should be comfortable to sit on, and they should be comfortable for abled and disabled.
Why don't we look into what the standards are and who makes the judge?
Well, at the time, they said, oh, this is the standard. And I was like, this is crazy. And there's still
standard and mandatory. Two different things, maybe.
Lisa Gordon, Chief of Design and Construction. I'll just jump in here that we've rebooted our standards committee, and the ADA bench is one that has come up as something that we need to revisit, and so that's part of a district-wide, we're working with that committee to look at that.
I think it would be good if people use them.
Yeah. Well, I think it would be good if you use different sized people per house in making a decision, whether you are 5'2" or 6'. Well, Lisa's the short person, but a tall person might have a different thing, and the back issue and so on. Thank you for adding that.
Sorry.
You are allowed a rant occasionally. Why not? And we'll see what Director Corbett does. Oh, you never know.
I say ditto to Director Wayne.
There you go.
But I would also like to ask, in the specs for the construction, as we know, pools are notorious for using lots and lots of energy for heating. So do the specs naturally include energy conservation efforts in whatever the design will be for the new pool, the heating systems, all that?
We'll make sure that it's considered as far as specs. We'll make sure that they're
Director
Lasky. Thank you. To follow up on Director Corbett's train of thought, having worked at that pool, I recall 100 years ago when I back flushed the filters, we'd shoot it right over the Grand Trail untreated. I'm wondering, even more specifically, I know there will be standards to heat a pool. It's going to be a lot different than it was 65 years ago to handle back flushing operation will be different, but I hope we're proactive in that, because I think there's a lot of opportunity if in fact back flushing, I'm sure it's more sophisticated now than those old diatomaceous earth filters we used to have, so we had a lot of water that we wasted away, but to water the adjacent the lawn that you sit on. We could easily, it's a short distance, easily landscaping that. I know that people will laugh when you say solar heating at Roberts. You never get enough sun to heat water there, but I hope we can look into something different and innovative there.
They do it in a lot of pools. Why not?
Yeah, I don't know if the RFP included the attractiveness of a pool when you expand it. It's a short pool. If I was a swim team, you couldn't have a meet there. If I were a water polo team, I couldn't really do much there. But if we expanded and let's bump it out 10 feet, or I hope there's a plan, because I think it would be very attractive, and I know that high schools are, burying their pools, and they're too expensive, so this may be very much more attractive, especially with water polo and things like that. And if we do depend upon the winter months of teaching people, and you refer to swim clubs, I assume they're for-profit swim clubs, I assume it's a model swim club. I hope we get a real agreement with those guys to contribute towards this $4 million that we're already spending on this. But I look forward to the project. I think it'll be great.
My goodness, were you expecting all of this conversation?
Why we're here.
Why not? And we have one more director.
I'm sorry. Toby, is there just a lack of interest of architects in doing pool projects?
I think it's more speaks to just the very...
You might bring the microphone up.
I think it just more speaks to the very busy time right now with construction ongoing. And then with respect to pools, for these large type of pools, there's not a whole lot of design firms that do this kind of work. It's a pretty specialized field from what I couldn't understand.
Director Coffey, if you look at our report that we did on the local grant program, a lot of cities used our local money to leverage their money to redo their pools. So clearly there's a big demand out there. And I think a lot of the local park and recreations have a big focus on the swim programs. Whereas, like you said, high schools and a lot of other park agencies are not doing as much swimming issues, but local park and recreation still has that as a pretty high priority. If you've been to the LARPD headquarters in Livermore, their facility there is just immaculate, and they really put a lot of their money into that regional park facility there, so they are very popular and very expensive. So it's just.
They're redoing.
Yeah, I think they are.
Too.
I think they are. I think it's a narrow expertise, but I think they're really busy.
Okay, Director Lane has another comment.
Yeah, so I have a short question based on Dennis's comment. So we are enlarging it. Are we enlarging it enough for a standard meet or for water polo or not?
So no decision, no design decisions have been made. These are some of the conversations we're going to have with our internal staff and the expertise of the consultants once we have them on board. My understanding is that the length of the pool is adequate for competitions, and that we need to widen it.
And that's what you're talking about.
And that's what we're talking about doing. Water polo is discussion we can have, but these are all parts of the design process that we'll be working on in the next several months.
Yeah, well, I think it's clearly it's been too small for these. Those events, and there's definitely a call for that. And so, just to weigh in, I think we should be meeting that sport as well.
Okay.
If I may, Toby, I think one thing, and Lisa, is we now have a major effort on our solar array at Shadow Cliffs, and what we haven't looked at is the issue of water, heating the water again.
Yes.
And I'd like to know what advancements. You know, could compare with your designer a passive heating system like we've done 25 years ago versus modern, mm-hmm. but you actually put a solar array on there to heat the water, and is there an efficiency there? I really do think it's a very high priority. I know we're covering the large amount of our electrical bills from Shadow Cliffs, but this is kind of a contained unit,
yeah.
and it would be good to really look at what we can do to save. I mean, the pools, just like Contra Loma, you know, pools, really the pumping is just a big cost on our electrical footprint. Even if we are covering the cost, it's still a big use, and we should try to diminish that.
And it's a showcase.
Any further discussion? Well, I think it's a great idea, too. Then they are not as much as these gentlemen. But it certainly seemed to me that it was a pool that was well used, but in need of a lot of love and care. And so I think you've heard a number of issues come up. I think the idea that it works to do solar for heating water makes a lot of sense. So a lot of dialogue from up here, but I think we'll soon see some universal support for this project. Do we have a really close estimate on the probable cost or not?
Well, $4 million right now.
You think we've added some sort of things to add on to it today.
Yeah.
I noticed.
The beauty.
It's going to be beautiful. It's going to have solar for the water.
I think what I'll just say is that we'll have a lot better information for
when you
come back in December.
If it costs a little more, it will be worth it. Okay, I need a motion.
I would like to make that motion.
We have a motion from Director Rosario. We have a second from Director Corbett. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Congratulations.
Thank you.
It passes. On to Operations Division. Approval to renew the special use agreement with Golden Gate Audubon Society, Martin Luther King Jr. Regional Shoreline.
Good afternoon, General Hunter, your Assistant General Manager of Operations. Managing almost 123,000 acres of parklands is a challenge, as all of you know. While the majority of the work to operate and maintain parks is done by our talented and committed park district staff, we also rely on the efforts of an army of volunteers and many community-based organizations. Normally, the items before you today would go on consent calendar. This is the extension of existing special use agreements. The general manager asked me to bring this item into open session to highlight the efforts of two of our community partners, that being Golden Gate Audubon Society and Save the Bay Organization. One of the things that's great when we work with these organizations and their volunteer efforts is not only do they work to educate people who attend their projects and their events, educate them about the value of wetland habitats. But they also, through their voluntary efforts, they get direct experience working to help us protect parklands. And I think that has a great value in terms of their advocacy for our parks. I want to also do some introductions here. I have Donna Ball, who is the Habitat Restoration Director for Save the Bay. Thank you for being here. And if I start stumbling on specifics of Save the Bay, I'm sure she'll jump up here and help me out with that. I also have Lisa Brodman, who's the Park Supervisor for Martin Luther King Jr. Regional Shoreline with us and works directly with both these organizations. And I have Katie Hornbeck, who's our Acting Business Services Manager, and Renee Patterson, who's our Admin Analyst, who works closely in developing these agreements and working with the organizations. And they can help out if we have specific questions about these agreements. Okay, I'm going to move on to the next. Let's see this. Okay, quickly, just an orientation to the areas that both these organizations work in. We have the, let's see if this works, East Creek up here to the north side of Martin Luther King Shoreline. This is the area coming along here. I'm trying to remember the name of this area. Lisa, help me out here.
Damon Marsh Trail.
Here we go. There's Damon Marsh and Damon Slough over on this side. The Edgewater area over here, wetland is over here. And this is Garrettson Point Trail here. The MLK service yard is here. Save the Bay, in addition to the work they do, which we'll get into here in a little bit, they also operate a native plant nursery in this area adjacent to our service yard. Then we come over here and we've got the Elmhurst Creek area here, San Leandro Creek Slough here, New Marsh, and Arrowhead Marsh. They work extensively throughout this area, different projects throughout the year. One thing that's really important is both of these organizations in terms of their connection to the park district. You know, I think all of you know that they played a significant role in legal and political battles, which led to the transfer of the more than 680 acres to the park district, which serves as the core of the Martin Luther King shoreline. And they've kept that interaction throughout the 1970s. They had worked with us through the 70s doing public education and restoration activities. The agreements we have, the formal agreements we have with them, started in 2010, and we're renewing them here with this action today, hopefully. Save the Bay, founded in 1961, committed to building partnerships with local civic groups, schools, businesses, resource agencies to restore tidal wetlands at MLK and throughout the San Francisco Bay Area. Their projects at MLK include the Native Plant Nursery, which they started in 2002, and they also do educational events. They have a big event called the Bay Day they do throughout the Bay, including Martin Luther King Shoreline. They also do work with school children. They also have events where people come out and work at the nursery and also do plantings and removal of invasive weeds throughout the wetland areas that they work in. All right, keep moving on here. Since March 2015, just to give you some idea of the numbers of folks that they work with, they've worked with more than almost 8,500 volunteers since March of 2015. These include 3,700 adults and about 4,700 youth. So great picture of the folks during the events out there. This is them, and a lot of their work on a monthly basis is around working, helping with the native plant nursery. They do a lot of work in the springtime preparing for that, so they can do their big planting events in the fall after the breeding season for the birds in the marsh. Number of plants installed since 2015, over 17,000 plants, native marsh plants installed. Weeds removed, 40,406. I don't know if that's pounds or individual weeds. Pounds, okay, that's what I thought. Okay, good. Pounds of trash removed. Also, it's really important. Both these groups work closely with park staff when we have our MLK Day, Junior Day of Service, and also our coastal cleanup events, which is very helpful. 22,000 pounds of trash removed by this one organization. They do a number of education programs, 164 in that time period. and over 3,800 students participating in those events. It's a great picture. I like this. These kids taking pride in that, getting connections to our parks. Goldgate Audubon, obviously one of our elder organizations in the environmental community since 1917. They engage people to experience the wonder of birds and translate that wonder to actions to protect wildlife and habitats. One of their key programs, unfortunately, Cindy Margulis couldn't join us today. I'll do my best to represent here. One of their key programs is their educational programs. They call it Eco Oakland Program. This is where they work with school kids in the third and fifth grade Title I schools, mostly low-income kids, trying to work with them to do programs to connect them to the wildlands and to our parks. They've worked with over 5,000 students and extended family in this time frame from 2015, both including educational and stewardship activities. The students have also removed over 1,800 pounds of trash in that time period. And I also want to emphasize that this group also joins us for our Martin Luther Jr. King Jr. Day of Service event and our Coastal Cleanup events. There's some of their educational programming. Nothing better than doing the skim of the bay and looking at what you find. They've also installed over 2,500 native plants put into the soil and then maintained as part of their agreements with us. They do not only do the plantings, but come back and maintain those areas to keep those, ensure the success of those plantings. And about 23 of these eco-ed field trips per year. Okay, I'm going to get to the details of the recommendation here. We're recommending to extend both agreements. We'll start with, there's two actions today before you. One, the first one here is Save the Bay. We're recommending another 10-year agreement with this organization. There are no fees to the participant, there are no costs. There are no fees to the participant, no costs for the organization for this work. And the recommendation is to extend a 10-year special use agreement with this organization. And I will pause here. For questions regarding this agreement.
It's in reverse order, but fine. Okay. Any questions? I don't think anybody up here is questioning anything you have said.
Okay.
Detailed question.
A comment.
Actually, it's a question.
That's a question.
So all these plantings, are we working all, are we all on the same page as far as a plan? Is there like a master plan for which areas are getting restored? And
so they do have quarterly meetings, and stewardship and operations meet with them. And then they work on their work plan to decide what's going to go on. The stewardship sets the parameters of that work. So that, if that answers your question,
yeah.
I also have Lisa here.
Why don't we ask the park supervisor to come up? She knows more than anyone in the area. She keeps them on track.
Yeah. Lisa Brogan, park supervisor. Yes, they have certain areas where they work. Golden Gate Audubon also gets a lot of their native shoreline plants from Save the Bay Nursery. And they plant over in the Arrowhead Marsh area. The Save the Bay has more of an extensive part where they have planted and take care of and mulch and weed. So they're very good park partners. We work really well together. So I highly recommend you approve of it.
Okay. There, you have the
answer. Lisa, while you're up, how long have you been park supervisor at this park?
2.5 years.
It's a very big park with a lot of responsibility. It's a very urban park. It tends to get a lot of wind-blown garbage, so no wonder they're picking up a lot. So any help you can get is probably appreciated.
Yes, because of the four major creeks that come in there, Vail or Upland, and that's where the majority of the garbage comes from.
Well, thank you.
What a wonderful agreement. Park supervisor and two agencies all working together.
Imagine that.
Any other questions, comments? If not, I would ask for a motion on renewing the agreement with the Golden Gate Audubon Society, Martin Luther King Jr. Regional Shoreline.
I would be glad to make the motion to extend these agreements, and I also, as part of that, just want to thank the organizations for the amazing work that they do. At the operations committee, we did ask them about how they bring students to the parks, and they have the same challenges we have. It costs more and more money to provide the transportation to bring students to the park. But in any event, I'll make that motion, and thank you for the work that you continue to do as partners with us. Appreciate it.
Director Corbett, do I have a second?
I'll second.
Director Rosario, questions or comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Hands? No. That no one says no. Then the motion passes, and we will go on to the other. We need a motion on Save the Bay for Restoration Project, Martin Luther King Jr. Regional Shoreline Extension.
So moved.
So moved from Corbett.
And second.
Second from Rosario. We had this as executive. I forgot, would we like to have a comment? Come on.
Sure.
You do such good work. I mean, and you came again, so please do it.
Well, I just want to pass it right back to you, to Donna Ball, Habitat Restoration Director of Save the Bay. But we couldn't do all this work without this great partnership, too, both with Golden Gate Audubon and with East Bay Regional Park staff. So we want to thank you as well.
Well, we thank you for your cooperation, and obviously the park appreciates it.
Thank you
for being here. So on that motion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? None. So thank you both for helping our supervisors stay on top of things. So.
Victor Wieskamp, I just think these are two great examples of how we stretch. That park, particularly that park, has a big burden, as the park supervisor notices, of trash that comes in from the shoreline, but also it's a very heavily used park. So being able to actually do restoration of habitat, which I know stewardship has been very involved in the choice of plants for bird habitat. Dr. Quack has been involved down there through stewardship for a long time. But also it really stretches the ability to get the litter picked up with these events. So I think this doesn't double our help, it kind of triples it, because we're doing habitat, we're doing work with the park staff, and we're being able to engage the community. And Director Corbett, I know you mentioned many times that how do you engage with the community out there? This is in some ways these organizations have even more reach than we do, because they have such a focus of certain areas, whether it's bird or habitat in the bay. It's just really an important way to get the community outreach out there.
Don, just another comment. Donna Ball from Save the Bay again. I think we shared with the committee before that often we're bringing kids, and so is Golden Gate Audubon, out to these sites that have never been to the edge of the bay before.
Absolutely.
And this is really a great part of your mission. So, and we really are glad to be able to do that. Thanks.
Thank you for it. This is not part of the mission, but this is a hot week coming up in Livermore, and this is one of the parks that I recommend to locals. If you want to go for a walk this week, go over and you'll see some nice birds in a beautiful park. Because it's a very unknown park in our part of the world. Roberts is another one, Hayward Shoreline, and your park, Redwood, is another one. But when it's 100 degrees in Livermore, it's better to go over the hill that way. And I think you do a beautiful job. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, board and staff reports, actions taken by other jurisdictions that affect the park.
Members of the board, you have two items of actions today, both Contra Costa County. And I think the write-up's pretty self-explanatory. I don't know if there's
any
questions.
Any questions on either of those items? Okay,
Dave. I'm just a little curious about where the 13 parcels are. Are they generally around Pleasant Hill Park, or
where are they?
It says Concord, Pleasant Hill, Wall Creek.
Okay.
We can get you that information, but they're along the strip. Some of them were bought separately from the rest of the right-of-way.
Okay.
So redevelopment stepped in at time. There's no more redevelopment. I think the majority were really around Hookston, the Hookston station area there. I think that was the redevelopment area, as I recall.
Okay, and the county will take care of
them. Yeah.
Okay.
Good. All right. Next, under General Manager's comment, the presentation.
So I have our great Chief of Planning and Concord Hills extraordinaire person. What a great event that was. And he's going to give an update on interagency planning. Brian.
Good afternoon, members of the board. Brian Holt, Chief of Planning and GIS. So we'll have a good opportunity to see some of the work from our great GIS department today. This is a presentation I've given to the board a couple different times. It's a pleasure to be here and sort of give you an update on our interagency planning projects and some of the larger, hotter ones that we happen to be working on. This is a body of work that is really integral to the district. It's something that sometimes goes unseen by a lot of others at the district, and that something that goes on for a long time and sort of behind the scenes and doesn't necessarily appear on the different budgets until a specific action comes forward. So actually Concord's a great example where we've been working on that for 14 years, working through a series of different public meetings, reviewing the IRs, reviewing a number of different documents, and only until just a couple weeks ago was the actual conveyance of land or the assignment of the possession of the property. I do want to recognize we've got a number of members of our staff of the Planning and GIS Department here. Neil Laval, our principal planner, Devin Reifler, also a principal planner, Chantal Alatori, Tanya Corver-Rubias, and Eddie Willis, who's joining us, who do a lot of this work for us. We're guided by the master plan, and what speaks to this work specifically is the vision statement that says that the district will provide leadership to guide land use decisions in the East Bay that relate to the district. So essentially what that means is that we monitor, and I don't have a clicker, so if you could advance from here. We monitor and review the two counties, 32 cities, the numerous special districts. We monitor all the agenda items, different public meetings, referrals, everything that comes through those agencies. We do that on a weekly basis and ultimately produce what we call the strategic actions by governmental entities, the SAGE weekly summary. That's distributed to our upper management and a number of folks throughout the district, which is just a listing of the relevant items, how it affects the district, and essentially starts a conversation about what areas that we might have interest in. And I found it to be a really key strategy to kind of get information from other members of the district on some of the long history we have. That will often kick us off into that engagement process with different either private developers, cities, or other entities. And then ultimately what happens is once action is decided on by those other jurisdictions, we come back to the board and we report on that on our actions report, which we just heard about. So yeah, essentially we work with project developers, state and local and regional agencies to ensure land use decisions do not impact district lands, minimize impacts to East Bay resources, and advance the district master plan when possible. I'm going to ask Naomi to open up and put together a little story map that kind of, I think you've seen before, but kind of gives a little bit of a map of our property. I was planning on going over just a couple of what I know are projects of interest to the board. I'm open to asking or answering other questions about others that you may have. The first one is Point Pilate. As you know, this has been a project that has been undergoing the planning process for some time, for about 270 acres, which would include about 100 acres of open space. This was the subject of a settlement agreement between the City of Richmond and the prior developer. The current proposal, they've selected a preferred developer, and the current proposal looks to develop 1,500 homes. You can see the site plan there. But essentially, they've released a notice of preparation. We just recently submitted a comment letter on that, just reiterating the district's interest in partnering with the City of Richmond should there be an interest in establishing a regional park there. The next one we're going to look at is the Lester property in the City of Pleasanton, actually just outside the City of Pleasanton. So it would require an annexation into the city. This is a project for developing about 37 lots adjacent to Pleasanton Ridge. This was an area identified as a priority access point for new staging and parking in the Pleasanton Ridge Land Use Plan. We've had some initial conversations with the project proponent, project developer, about developing a staging area there. We continue to have some conversations about the location and design, but this is really in the early process. Its application has been submitted to the city, and they're currently reviewing it, and we're awaiting the next steps, which will be starting the environmental review process and a notice of preparation, and engaging in that public process there. The next project we're going to just quickly update on was Alameda Point. We've heard the board's interest and the city council's interest in having the district and the city move forward with a memorandum of understanding there. We've been having those discussions. We recently visited the site with city staff and have looked at what an interim sort of public access concept might be that would be essentially incorporating some segments of the Bay Trail there. So I think we've got some meetings on the calendar soon, and we continue to have those conversations with the city. The next one I believe we're going to talk about is Ball Estates. This is a very current project that will be heard by the County Planning Commission tomorrow night. This is one that we've been engaged in for a very long time, and we've had an interest in establishing a staging area that would serve Las Trombas and the Las Trombas to Mount Diablo Regional Trail, and have tried to work with the developer and having them including a staging area for the district. I've had some ongoing discussions about the design and the location of that staging area, and we hope to get some additional information as that goes forward tomorrow at the Planning Commission. And then next would be McGee Preserve. This is also in Danville. Actually, the last one's in Contra Costa County. This one's being processed by Danville. This property also been around for about 10 years, developing 69 homes on 38 acres and retaining about 380 acres as open space. We've worked with this developer for a number of years now to kind of get to the point that they have the footprint that they have. This has been approved twice by the Danville City Council. First time it was litigated, and they had to do additional analysis regarding bicycle safety. It was just recently approved again, with the idea that the open space would be accessible to the public. The district would take over some trail and access easements, and that area would be preserved in perpetuity. I believe there's potential signature gathering going on in the town of Danville, and it might go up for a referendum. So not necessarily complete yet, so we continue to monitor that one as well. The ranch project in Antioch off of Deer Valley Road, adjacent to Deer Valley Regional Preserve. This is an area, one of the last big development opportunities within the urban limit line in Antioch. We propose up to 1,300 residential units. Similarly, have talked with them about potential for staging areas that we want to see to provide protected, to provide a buffer to Deer Valley Regional Preserve, inclusion of some trails, and looking at strategies for the permanent closure of Empire Mine Road, which is a big priority for the Park District. That project was approved under by the council under an initiative, but ultimately is under litigation now too. So we continue to monitor that to see what sort of resolution happens there. So those were the key items that I know of that are of interest to the district. Like I say, that are hot right now. I'm happy to answer any other questions on other projects and other areas, and Neoma can navigate us around the East Bay here, and just kudos again to our GIS department for the great mapping work that they do in helping us put together these presentations.
Thank you.
some projects just keep on going, don't they? Do we have any questions or comments? Does that sum it up well enough? We may get more information from you on the same projects as things go on.
I'm sure you will.
From the general manager, I just can't tell you the importance of even keeping board members informed this way, let alone what we get from it, which is usually a dedication, a better boundary, something that way that benefits the district. But it's also what you hear from people in the community saying, what are we doing about this? What's going on here? Can you, what I call the 911 calls, save the property? And so it's a small part of the big planning that planning does, but it's a really, really important continuity of our mission, because there are just some places we would like to preserve, but that would never be for sale. It would not be a good strategy to try to use eminent domain for the project, because you find out that the city or the everybody's in favor of the development but us or some community group. So it's really important, and I really want to compliment the staff for keeping track of an awful lot of projects. One thing that's happened since the recession is development and density in these projects, some of them were 20 years old, put on the back shelf, have now come forward again. So it really is a very busy time.
A very busy time, absolutely. And I just want to say, just for the board and for management and staff, we work really hard to try to keep our finger on the pulse on, you know, just about everything that's going on out there, and sort of trying to at least understand where things are in the process, or at least knowing where to go to understand if we need to get additional information. So I always like to try to use the opportunity to give a plug that if something comes up that is of interest that is coming through another agency, to, you know, get planning a call or see what we might know about it, because chances are it's on our radar in some way, shape, or form.
It helps keep you busy. I do believe that Director Lane has a comment.
Well, and you know,
he's very busy too.
Brian and staff, likewise, if there's something that comes up locally that you don't quite have a grapple on, you might try calling the board. Because sometimes we know something about it.
That's a great reminder.
Sometimes.
Okay.
But we appreciate it, because you just have a lot of agencies to deal with, and we know that. And it's not an easy thing for staff to keep track of, or even the board, no matter how we all try. Okay, anything else? Colin?
Me?
Yeah.
For the board's information, maybe the general manager could concur. There have been some legal developments with the Sand Creek development out in the Antioch, both some decisions in the pending litigation and the likelihood of a new initiative going on the ballot in Antioch, and a combination of interests the district has in these development plans out there. It might be worthy, no hurry, at some point for probably a closed session update on that matter, just because it is so complex and it is rather significant.
We will do that. There may actually be something as an action to report on, too, if it gets to in front of the council. So I think Brian can pick that up, but we can also discuss it as a potential litigation item if appropriate. But it is confusing what they actually did. I think they're just basically rebooting. They're at the same thing, but they had this kind of start over on a couple of them. But we'll get you an update.
I hope someone could explain.
Okay. Anything further for Brian? Yes.
Brian, I don't want to get too deep in the woods, but if you could give me a yes or no answer, you talk about things on your radar. Have you heard of Ramirez Ranch, 37 acres adjacent to Quarry Lakes, Caltrans property that was sold to Union City for some type of plan?
Generally, I'm familiar with the Caltrans surplus properties around Quarry Lakes, and we've had some meetings with the city of Newark and Fremont around some of their the Highway 84 extension of the parkway and some of that stuff that I believe relates to that area. So we've looked at that whole sort of master plan very closely.
Great. Thank you. I'll talk to you offline.
And actually, I think we have that mapped upstairs.
Yeah, we do. I'm not familiar with the term Ramirez Ranch. I've heard it called a number of other things over the years, but looking at this area that NAM has zoomed in there. We're very aware of this area.
Great, thanks.
Okay, anything further? If not,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Announcements from closed session?
Director Wieskamp, there's no announcements from closed session.
Okay. Board committee reports. First one is the legislative committee, 19. Anything? Yes.
I'm just interested in being kept informed about AB 1025, which is the right-of-way forgiveness of the loan for the county. And I'm assuming that we found the language there was acceptable to us. They had to do that thing, putting somebody on the corner.
I think that's the best we could get. I'll put it that way.
Okay. All right. Then the next three are legislative committees. Does anyone have any questions on any one of those? Comments? And the last one is the Finance Committee. Okay. Then public comments. Do we have any public comments at this time?
Oh yes. Kelly Abreu. Thought we were going to have it at the very end.
There's a thing called the East Bay Greenway Trail, 1.7 miles in Fremont. It runs from Central Park up towards the Alameda Creek Trail, Niles Canyon, and runs along the UP, Union Pacific Railroad right-of-way. City of Fremont is busy running and hiding from this project. They don't want to talk about it anymore. They put out rumors of toxic waste, but of course every railroad has toxic waste along the railroad. Otherwise, we wouldn't have an iron horse trail. If people were afraid of a little toxic waste along the railroad lines, there would be no iron horse trail, I promise you that. Then when it comes to this idea of what we just heard, this whole philosophy that he's doing, where he goes to developments and he's trying to improve access points and increase the number of access points, and that whole philosophy is completely absent from the thinking and the planning and the city policy of the city of Fremont. And the Mission Peak disaster, Mission Peak in terms of access, in terms of parking tickets, in terms of every other public relations warfare campaign against Mission Peak, sponsored by some government agencies. All of that comes from the absence of this kind of philosophy. Because this philosophy was not in place in Fremont. Let's start with Calaveras Road, the county line. There's an access point there, but it's not part of this park. It is part of the Dallas Santa Clara or whatever, Ad Levin Park, whatever they call it. You go for another 5 miles to the north. The city could plan developments, private, not like subdivisions, like a regular subdivision. They put private land, gated subdivisions that nobody can walk into, nobody can ride a bike into, and all the way from that line, from there, to the narrow choke point that is Stanford Avenue. And one particular development, I'll call your Avalon Estates. That was put in about 20, 30 years ago. It's very much like this Bell Estates or Western property, except it's completely gated, and nobody can get there, and you can't use it as an access point to the local parks. That's helps to then from then going northwards from Stanford Avenue, another 2 miles till you get to Ohlone College. Again, lined with private gated communities to keep people out. And, of course, there are little waterways. Those are potential access points to parks. Nobody wants to talk about those, but they do exist because you physically can't destroy them, and so they're physically there. And then, so there's private gated communities. Then the next one is Mill Creek Road. What happened at Mill Creek Road? The park district actually won't let you walk up the road for 2 miles to walk into the park because they put up signs saying no access from Mill Creek Road. That was only a couple of years ago. Finally, I'd like to talk briefly about Mission Peak Winery. Mission Peak Winery just opened a few weeks ago, a few months ago, a few years ago. Mission Peak Winery is on Mill Creek Road, and I highly recommend all of you go to their website, take a look. We put it on our website. Mission Peak Winery, it's a delight to look at. You know how what they do for access? You
call up your friend. You can arrange your event at their facility. It's very nice. It's got several 7 acres of grapes or whatever. It's a luxurious facility. It's got a great view of Mission Peak. It's right there. And guess what they have? A truly unique feature. You'll never imagine this. When your guests arrive at the San Francisco airport, Oakland, wherever, any kind of major airport like San Francisco, SFO, they will helicopter them in with their private helicopter to their facility, included in the service. And it's a beautiful helicopter. I want somebody, I'd like to meet somebody who takes a helicopter ride. Thank you.
A unique facility with a unique way of getting there. Thanks for coming. All right. Anyone else from the public?
No, Madam President.
Then I will go to board comment, and we will start with, I see the look in his eye. We will go to Director Coffee. He's ready.
I don't know what that look was. You insist.
I misinterpreted.
It might have been one of those looks I look over.
I'll go the other way.
No, I'm good.
You're good.
I'm good. I forgot to mention last night that I had the honor of representing this board and organization before the Contra Costa Board of Supervisors on July 9th, at which time the Contra Costa Board of Supervisors presented the district with a resolution honoring the 85th anniversary of the founding of the district. And I attended along with Eric and Lisa. And it was a very fine event, and again, a great honor to represent the district before that board of supervisors. On July 19, I attended the legislative committee. July 20, I participated at the Trudeau Center, an annual ambassador training, and I noticed Carol put out some photographs from that training. As you can tell, I'm totally not engaged in this process. It was a good turnout. It was about 30 people, a mix of brand new ambassadors and existing ambassadors there for an update and orientation. And Jen and Carol and I got to present, and as a result, we have a new crew of ambassadors out and about. On the 22nd, I enjoyed the PAC annual barbecue. This was out of Martin Luther King, and happy to have been able to attend. On July 23, this comes under the category of it's a tough job, but somebody has to do it. Mike Moran and his staff invited Neil and me to attend a kayaking outing with new ISAs and big break docents. So we spent more about a big break paddling around and getting direction from Mike Moran is how to interpret while you're paddling. I could do that. I was really happy to get invited to share. July 25th, I attended the board field trip to Crab Cove and Encinal Beach, and I appreciate all the staff that are on that outing. August 8th, Brian and Christina Kelchner, Brian Holt, and I were given a tour by the Oakley city manager and the mayor of Oakley of the 55 acres that Oakley has been granted by the state of California in connection with the Dutch Slough Marsh Restoration Project. I think it's approximately 1,000 acres across Dutch Slough from Bethel Island and Jersey Island. And the Park District does have some existing plans for extending Marsh Creek Trail adjacent to the new city park and the state marsh restoration project. I hadn't seen that project or the land involved, and appreciated the tour and Christina and Brian's assistance in checking out the properties and what future partnerships can exist with both the state of California and the city of Oakley out there. And finally, on August 12th, it was at Beverly yesterday, Director Lane's invitation, I attended an informal meeting with the Mayor of Concord and Vice Mayor of Concord to discuss the resurrection of the Concord district liaison relationship to discuss Concord Hills planning and City of Concord's development plans adjacent to the park.
Sounds like a good start.
It was.
Director Corbett.
Thank you. On July 18th, I attended our regular operations committee meeting, and then I represented the district at the Greater and Greener Conference in Denver. I look forward to bringing to you some of the interesting things I learned while I was there. A couple of things that were quite interesting was how the Denver Parks deal with noxious weeds, and Denver Parks is a very interesting organization because they have their local community city parks and downtown pockets and all that, but they also have mountain parks up into the mountain areas, and they do a lot of programs trying to bring people from neighborhoods up into the mountains, but also bring experiences into the local areas where they're more accessible as well for those that don't have as much access to their mountain parks. So it's very interesting to hear. They also have a huge amount of efforts they put into establishing partnerships with other organizations to do the work that they do, sort of what we were talking about today. And I look forward to talking a little bit more about how we do that as well. So thank you for sending me there. It was very worthwhile. Well, also something new this year. This is the second time I've gone to the Greater Premier Conference. I don't know if they've done this in the past, but they seem to have an emphasis on inviting graduate students to the conferences to study different issues in park theory. And two of the students that I ran into and had the opportunity to have conversations with were working on access to parks. So anyway, I thought that was quite interesting to bring students in to study some of these issues from a very early point. On the 26th, I attended the field trip to Alameda, where we got a chance to take a look at the great improvements that are happening at Breakwater Park in cooperation with the city of Alameda, and also, of course, visited Crab Cove to see all the amazing things that are done there on a regular basis, and the great classrooms and study areas and touch tanks and all of that great stuff there. It's so nice and wonderful on these field trips also to have a chance to meet and talk to our staff. And as we know, we have a very enthusiastic bunch there, including the chief naturalist, who you all know is very into his great work there. That evening, I attended Supervisor Scott Haggerty's barbecue. And then the last thing I have to report was on August 1st, I attended our executive committee. Okay, thank you. Director Lane.
Thank you. It's been a while since we had a meeting. Here we are in the middle of August.
Here we are.
But I don't have that much to report because I went to Yellowstone.
Well, now we know what you were
doing.
I was researching parks, and I do want you to know that we had a bison that decided to cross right in front of our car.
Nice.
And fortunately, the son who drives slowly was driving slowly, and so we stopped. And
I think that's a good idea.
It's a large animal.
Yes, it is.
But he didn't care one whit for us. He just wanted to get the grass on the other side, I think. But that was the closest we got. And the other thing that happened was the first day we went and stayed near the park was the day that a buffalo had tossed this young girl. Remember seeing that viral video that somebody took? And so we were looking at it and saying, here are some things we don't want to do while we're at Yellowstone.
I would say that's good.
Yeah, it was a lovely trip. I did go to operations, enjoyed the Port Chicago 75th anniversary event out at the National Monument on the Wednesday before I left. It was really lovely, and Kelly English did the explanation of the Port Chicago explosion, and she did just a beautiful job.
of it. And I had a chance to talk to the Concord city manager, and it was always a nice place to see other people at that event. Then with Colin, I did have the opportunity to talk to the mayor and vice mayor of Concord yesterday, and they had some ideas for future meetings that I started to share with you. Also, I went to the Transportation Authority with Eric and Lisa and had a little discussion about what they were, well, with Don Tassin, and discussed what they were proposing for their transportation expenditure plan. Or, as everyone in the authority says, the TEP. So I felt fortunate that I knew what the TEP meant, because I'm not really wired into transportation too much anymore. And then I went to the elected women's lunch in San Ramon. I always try to go to them if they're close to me. This is the Tri-Valley ones, and we had Congressman Swalwell come and talk to us about safety. And East Bay MUD director Frank Nellen talked to us, as only Frank can, about East Bay MUD. So that had its interesting aspects. I am sorry I missed going to the beach at Alameda, and I'm going to try and set up something to see how that facility looks, because I think it's quite different. I'm sorry to hear that Mark Crumpter, who is the photographer for this, and who's done photography all over East County, and particularly around Valley, so beautiful that he's moving to Nevada.
Yeah.
Sharon told me that. I'll certainly miss these beautiful photographs. I hope so. Then I have been working with my history hat on the women's suffrage, Women Won the Vote celebration, which will kick off this August. Because next August was when the most important amendment besides the Bill of Rights was ratified for the country, and that was the Women's Vote. I'm starting to have a really good time with it. And then finally, I'm spending some time on Camille staging area, as Brian mentioned, you know, a little bit on Burrell. And so I'm happy the RFP is out. And as we are talking about it, I am ever more aware that I have no visitor center in 46. Yet. Yeah. And so with that, that's enough.
Thank you. Director Wasby.
Thank you. On July 19th, I met with Rachel Arbios, I hope I pronounced her name right, the intern that we've hired to study art in the parks. She had some great ideas, and we talked about a lot of great things. So I look forward to her report at the end of her time here. I also attended the legislative committee that day. On the 22nd, I attended the PAC meeting at Martin Luther King, the annual barbecue. Had some great issues brought up, and I'm always intrigued and amazed at the breadth of knowledge of our PAC members. On July 23rd, I attended the Union City State of the City address. Carol Dutra-Vernacci gave a wonderful report on her city that she's very proud of. And the 26th, I attended the board field trip at Crown Beach and Crab Cove. On the 1st, I attended the executive committee, and on August 8th, I met with Lisa Gorgian and Matt Grawl at their request to kind of, which I think is an excellent idea. They were kind of updating me on what was going on at the Hayward Marsh, and I truly appreciate it. They're not here now, but I appreciate that they're giving me that courtesy to talk to me about that. And finally, I'm having lots of fun, and so are my neighbors with all the goats at Lake Chabot, doing their job to keep the field break nice and clear. And they're a great interpretive tool and a lot of fun. That's it for me.
Thank you.
Nothing is more popular than goats, I see. Director Rosario.
Free beer plans.
Goats and free beer.
Let's see. On the 19th, I was called in to pinch hit for Whitney at the legislative committee meeting, and I'm glad to see you here today. And then on the 20th, I attended the Richmond Music Festival at Shields Community Park, and what a lovely little event. I think maybe next year we can find some way to maybe support that group that they've requested for several years to have one of our naturalist bands to go there. The music was exceptional. All local musicians, all local community, and it was a beautiful day. And people were very nice. I'd go back.
That's a good
barbecue too. And then on the 22nd, I attended the PAC barbecue and meeting, and like Director Waspy, our PAC members are very well, their breadth of knowledge is incredible. And they ask very good questions. And then on the 25th, I met with Deborah Walker and Jeff Rasmussen regarding the solar panel array, and that was very good and resulted in getting those readings on our check registers. So I now understand how it all works. Very nice. And attended the field trip in Alameda and Breakwater Beach. And incredible what's going on at Crab Cove and then what's going to happen at the Breakwater Beach there. That is one popular little place. I had no idea that little beach had that many activities going on all at once. So any improvements there will be, the people will be very well pleased. On the 28th, I attended Denise DeFries' retirement reunions. What a perfect day that was. It was in the shade, didn't feel the heat that much, and I left early before sundown. But everybody's in good spirits. Then on the 31st, I attended the Berkeley Chamber annual meeting in Mixer, and I found out that the Berkeley Chamber is the only independent Chamber of Commerce in the United States. They're not associated with the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. Yeah. Made some good connections there, too. And then on the 8th, August 1st, I attended the Country Cost Mayors Conference. Just for the corn.
Right.
Which you did get. Yes, the brick of corn. But I also, in one of the reports about the Bay Area Air Quality Management District, there is a conference in Portland, Oregon in November. It's all about electric vehicles. You might think about sending somebody from staff up there maybe. I'll try to get some more information on that. And then on the 3rd, I attended. Talk about free beer. I went to What's Brewing at Port Canoa. Again, perfect weather. Of course, I got there just in time for the beer ran out. But they had a Filipino food truck, and I got pork adobo.
Now we know what you want.
Woohoo, I was happy. And the band, even without the, there was a small band there, even without the, some of their equipment went missing, but it was all acoustic. It was pleasant. Very nice. Very well done. Thank you, Juliana and Regional Parks Department Foundation. And then on 8-7, I met with Lisa Gorshin, and we also had talked about Project Sir Roberts and McCosker. So I think that's a great way for the board members to really go in depth on those projects. Good idea. And then on the 11th, I went to the 2428 annual barbecue. Thank you very much. Very nice. Got to meet some of the, a lot of new faces I didn't know. Change over there, change over here, and very nice. And That's it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Busy guy. Yeah. Director Johnson.
Yes. I've been in operations, in terms of some of my health issues. But I'm feeling very good being back involved. I definitely want to stay involved, but at a different pace. And I think that one of the things that we can work with is extending some continuity to some of our events and activities. I've got some issues regarding maintaining access to my Louisiana interests, which will all be phased in all over time. But I definitely feel that the connection to the board has been awesome. It's quiet back there. I went to the North Michigan Shoreline Festival. Yeah. And that was a nice event. And I've maintained connection to so many people kind of around the Bay Area, it's hard to remember some of the impacts that I've had over the years since 1971. When I graduated from the University School of Public Health, and there's been an interest in health issues that I've had for a long time. Now it's time to walks in the jungle in Suriname and also rebuilding, or I can't do any physical work at this one. I could do it, but I don't trust it. Anya has seen some of the work that I've done in Louisiana, so I plan to that's all.
Okay. Well, we're glad that you were feeling better.
Yeah.
Okay. On the 18th, I attended operations and then a LAFCO meeting. I went to the groundbreaking of the wonderful bridge that has been pulled together by Tri-Valley Conservancy. I have a shovel in my garage. It's gold-plated, but I don't think it's real gold, so I'm trying to bring it in for anybody who needs a gold-plated shovel. The chamber luncheon was dealing with economic issues both in the valley and around the whole Bay Area. I love the field trip to Alameda, and I would like to say I would like to appreciate all those people who have been involved in redoing the visitor center, because I think the integrity of the project, the style of the wood, everything is wonderful, but I like the fact that they lightened it up, light and bright throughout between windows and paint. I think it should be a delight for all those groups that come in and use it. And so it's a wonderful place and lots of future things happening there for Director Corbett. Elected women, I appreciated the presentations from both Congressman Swalwell and from Frank Mellon, who is always willing to talk to you about East Bay Mud. You learned a few things, so that was good. I appreciate that. I think it was important that we had a staff member attending the N3 Ranch first meeting. Supervisor Haggy was not able to be there, but he had assured me that the partnership would be included. We have a relationship between the land that we lease to the cattle operation now in Ohlone and obviously the connection by Del Valle. I hope something wonderful happens from all those people who are involved at this stage and agencies. Could somebody tell me about our pond status? Yesterday on PBS, I heard about in the South, suddenly they were having various kinds of substances and a lot of dogs. Evidently, it was unusual in the South. Have we had any problems with our algae at all? Do we know? Well, you can get back to me later to assure that I didn't know it was the same issue. These dogs were dying within an hour.
Yeah, North Carolina.
Yeah, I mean, just unusual. So let's keep an eye on it.
I was thinking South Bay.
Oh, I'm talking about the deep south.
Big south.
The real south.
And I remind everyone that the Ohlone College Street Fair, the last one of the year, is happening on August 31st. I'm sure Benny will be there. And if there's something we want to do, I think it's been fairly successful. So I think anything we can do to keep that going is a good one. And so is there anything else anyone needs to add? If my voice is going, I will...
And what was that date for the Ohlone?
August 31st.
Okay.
With that, nothing to be added, I will declare the meeting adjourned.
Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
We got through it.